Dear students, we completed our discussion on social contract theory. We discussed separately three different theories: the social contract theory of Thomas Hobbes, social contract theory of John Locke, and finally the social contract theory of Rousseau. We have seen how state is the result of the contract that was entered into by the people. And we also discussed about the nature of human being during the state of nature, which you all know was the state before the state was created. It was the condition, it was the situation when there was no state, and how human being behaved himself, and why he has created the state. Because any political theory or any political phenomena has to be studied from the point of view of the necessity of a human being, necessity of human being in general. We learned the social contract theory, which laid the foundation for the emergence of individualism and liberalism, how man became center of the society, and state, especially state, was a mechanism to achieve the goals that were imposed by human being himself. And these social contract theory laid foundation for the emergence of a constitutional government and also popular sovereignty. They have been the basis, the real basis of a democratic government or a democratic society. So today, what we are going to do is to have a discussion on the comparative, the comparative understanding of the social contract theory, after having known the different social contract theories of different philosophers. Today we are going to have a discussion on the comparative understanding of the social contract theory of Thomas Hobbes, John Locke, and Rousseau. Let us see. Share the screen. Okay, right. Social contract theory, a comparative study of Thomas Hobbes, Locke, and Rousseau. As we have been discussing, social contract theory is a speculation about the birth of the state out of contract entered into by people among themselves. The social contract theory of Thomas Hobbes, John Locke, and Rousseau. These were the great philosophers. Yes, Thomas Hobbes belonged to 16th and 17th century, especially 17th century. John Locke was also 17th century philosopher, and Rousseau, he belonged to, as you can see, 18th century. So 17th and 18th century, as you all know, it was in mid 18th century the Industrial Revolution began, and the Thomas Hobbes period was the glorious revolution happened in England. John Locke was a little bit later period. He wrote his book after the glorious revolution, supporting the glorious revolution, and you know, speculating on imposing some limitations on the absolute monarchy, and he was for limited government. And Rousseau's concept of general will laid, you know, foundation for the popular sovereignty. Now we see the important works of Thomas Hobbes. Leviathan, he wrote Leviathan in 1651 when there was civil war in England, and everywhere there would be chaotic conditions in England, and therefore the conditions that prevailed during that time influenced his work. And John Locke too treatises on civil government. That was written in 1689 and 90. And Rousseau's work was The Origin of Inequality. We learned how, what was the reason for origin of inequality. With the emergence of family and private property, the inequality has begun to take shape. Human nature. Now, taking, you know, each and every dimension, and we will look at the comparative analysis of these three great philosophers. Thomas Hobbes, human nature. According to Thomas Hobbes, human being was selfish and cruel. So that was the perception Thomas Hobbes had, because there existed chaotic situation in England. So man behaved selfishly, and he basically believed that human being was selfish and cruel. He wants to have everything to himself, and he could compete. He competes with his fellow human being. That competition results in fight, results in warlike situation. Everywhere there would be warlike situation, and that makes the human being to avoid that situation and to enter into social contract to create a state with absolute monarchical power. So that is what he said. Thomas Hobbes had this perception about human nature. And John Locke, so quite contrary to what Thomas Hobbes held about the human nature, John Locke said that human being was a rational being, and therefore he wants to live in peace because he expects the same peace from other fellow human beings. And that rationality, which is based on reason, enables him to live with his fellow human beings in peaceful atmosphere. So what John Locke believes, human being basically is a peace-loving animal, is a peace-loving human being. Rousseau said about human nature during State of Nature, the human being was simple and innocent. He was a noble savage. He lived very closer to the nature, and therefore he was very simple and innocent. He enjoyed the real freedom during State of Nature, because he did not know the modern vices like jealous and competition, conspiracy. All these characters were not there when he lived very closer to the nature. That is what Rousseau said about human nature. About State of Nature. What kind of state of nature they visualized? According to Thomas Hobbes, there was war of everyone against everyone because of the selfish nature of human being. Human being was solitary, nasty, and dangerous. And therefore, he always know, acted very selfishly. That selfishness resulted in competition, and competition led to conflict. That conflict, you know, was the reason for warlike situation that prevailed during state of nature. That is what, you know, Thomas Hobbes had a view of state of nature. According to John Locke, state of nature was state of peace, goodwill, and mutual assistance. So according to John Locke, because a human being was rational, he could think, you know, rationally. Therefore, he wanted, you know, peace. He was very cooperative with his human fellow human being. And therefore, there prevailed a state of peace, goodwill, and mutual assistance. So it is quite, you know, entirely different view that John Locke had about state of nature. Rousseau said state of idyllic blissfulness. Idyllic here means complete. Here, real, you know, happiness. Human being enjoyed real happiness during state of nature because he was very innocent. He was a noble savage. He did not know the modern, you know, human being's characteristic features of selfishness, you know, conspiracy, jealous. These were not there when he lived in the state of nature. When these bad characters were absent, he was very innocent and he enjoyed real freedom. That is what Rousseau had, the perception of state of nature. The reasons for the contract. So now the question arises, man wanted to come out of the state of nature. So what were the reasons for which, you know, human being entered into contract? According to Thomas Hobbes, John Locke, and Rousseau. According to Thomas Hobbes, it was to escape war, warlike situation. There was war everywhere because Thomas Hobbes said human being was having two characteristics. One is he is very selfish, that results in a warlike situation. And another one is he has also have the capacity to think. That capacity to think made him to realize that warlike situation would finish all. And therefore, to escape that warlike situation, he wanted to come out to protect himself and his property. And so to escape from the warlike situation, man entered into contract. You know, human beings entered into contract among themselves and created a sovereign state. And sovereign state was not party to the contract. It was the people who were party to the contract, and they surrendered their rights to the sovereign power, and they wanted the sovereign power to regulate and provide security to their lives. That was the reason why human being entered into contract. And according to John Locke, even though human being was peace loving, he was basically good and cooperative, but he wanted to avert war because the peace was precarious. John Locke said, even though there existed peace, even though man lived in peace, but that peaceful condition was precarious. That when that peaceful condition would, you know, come to an end, nobody knew. And therefore, people wanted to come out of that uncertainty because about warlike situation. Because John Locke said in the state of nature, even though peace prevailed, a few sections or a few people may disturb that peace. And when that peace would be disturbed, nobody knows. To avoid that impending disturbance or impending threat to the peaceful condition, they wanted to establish a government to provide, you know, security and also to protect the rights, natural rights. So the natural rights, according to John Locke, were right to live, right to liberty, and right to property. So the protection of these basic liberties, the natural rights, was very important to John Locke, and he created a government which was limited in the sense the government has to protect the natural rights, those three natural rights: right to live, right to property, and right to freedom. So these were the natural rights that are accrued to every human being on equal basis. So to avert war, according to John Locke, people entered into contract and created a government, a civil society and a government. Rousseau. So according to Rousseau, the contract was to reconcile lost freedom with the emergence of family and property. Because human being, with the emergence of the state, or after the emergence of family and property, he lost his freedom. But once he lost his freedom, and after the emergence of family and property and civilization, he lost his freedom, and also he lost his innocence. So man became very cruel. Now, a situation has come where human being cannot go back to the state of nature, where there would be no family and property. That is not possible, and therefore people, to reconcile their lost freedom with the emergence of family and property, they entered into contract to create a political organization, to create, you know, general will, to which the sovereign power was given. So they entered into contract to reconcile the lost freedom with the emergence of family and property, according to Rousseau. Nature of social contract. Thomas Hobbes, according to Thomas Hobbes, people entered into contract, surrendered their natural rights to the sovereign power. They wanted absolute sovereignty, because Thomas Hobbes thought human being was cruel and he had to be controlled. And if his behavior was to be controlled, there must be a sovereign power which was absolute. So that is why he favored absolute sovereignty. So he developed his theory, social contract theory during the time when there was chaotic conditions everywhere in England. There was civil war in England between parliament and the king. So that is why he favored a absolute monarchical government, so that it could protect the human beings and his property. So that was the nature of contract that people entered into to create an absolute monarchical government. And John Locke, according to John Locke, he basically believed in natural rights, the rights that were naturally accrued to human being out of the reasoning capacity of human being. Those three rights are right to life, right to freedom, and right to property. These are the natural rights for which they created a government, a civil society and government. That government should protect the natural rights. If natural rights are not protected, then people have, he said, every right to remove the government. Limited in the sense, the sovereign power of the state should work within the purview of the natural rights. So natural rights became very important. Human being and his natural rights became very important. Earlier, you know, before John Locke, there was a theory called divine right theory, where king had divinity and people should respect. People are there just at the mercy of the king. That was the belief, and that was the theory that existed. And he criticized that kind of theory, and he wanted to replace that theory with limited sovereignty, so that people enjoy their natural rights. And Rousseau, popular sovereignty. Popular sovereignty was with general will. General will was conscious of all of common good. Consciousness of all of common good. So that consciousness or common good has to be, you know, has to be made update every time. That can be possible only when people gather and take decision, you know, when they take collective decision. So he was for limited population so that people actively participate in the government and determine the common good. Common good has to be decided every, you know, time based on the expression of the will of the people. And every human being has got two wills, actual will and real will. And one will always, you know, gives importance to, selfish attitude or selfish needs. And another will is about the broader will. A human being thinks, you know, for the common good. So the thinking common good, everybody thinking about common good, is general will, to which everybody has to surrender their rights and the lost rights. So because of the contract, whatever rights human being loses would get back as a member of the, you know, community. So that is how the general will was propounded. And then liberty. What they viewed, how they viewed. Thomas Hobbes, according to Thomas Hobbes, liberty was license in the state of nature. Liberty is what the sovereign permits. So everybody enjoyed his own liberty, and there was warlike situation, there was conflict everywhere. And because of that, they entered into contract and created a absolute sovereignty. That absolute sovereignty, everybody surrendered his rights. If he has to enjoy any liberty, that is the permission given by the sovereign state. So liberty is what the sovereign permits. And John Locke, liberty on the basis of natural rights, state cannot take away rights. So according to John Locke, liberty was nothing but enjoying the natural rights by every human being on equal basis, and the state cannot take away those rights. The government has to function within the purview of the natural rights, and it cannot transgress the natural rights. Rousseau, liberty is the gift of the general will. So whatever human being loses when he entered into contract would get back as a member of the community. So when human being takes part in politics, in government affairs, in deciding the common good, then he enjoys the liberty. So it is the gift of the general will. General will is a kind of, you know, collective decision making for the benefit of all, for the welfare of all. That collective decision making of the common good is the result of the participation by every human being. By participating in the governance, in governmental affairs, everybody will enjoy liberty. So that is what Rousseau perceived. After having discussed these three social contract theories, we have come to know the importance of social contract theory. The social contract theory was speculative. It was not real. Historically, there was no contract as such, but it was the assumption. It was the speculation about why a human being obliges the state, why he has created the state. So the creation of the state shows the human beings understanding, tacit understanding of the necessity of the state, and the way he lived before the state, before the creation of the state. So some philosophers viewed the state of nature as pre-social, some viewed it as pre-social and pre-political. So that is how we should understand the social contract theory of these three great philosophers. Once again, go through these slides. This is human nature. This is state of nature. This is reasons for the contract, nature of the social contract, and liberty. Right. These are the important slides. You must go through once again and listen to the, watch this video. And if you have any doubts, please ask me. I will clarify the doubts. Thank you. Okay. And tomorrow, in the next class, we'll be discussing about the evolutionary theory of social contract, the evolutionary theory of origin of state, how state has come into being, how nation states have emerged, and what were the factors, how human being, you know, started his life, and how he started his life with the emergence of family, and why family was born. And those are the important topics to be discussed. And in the next class, we will take up that topic, evolutionary theory of origin of the state. Okay.